something that was just talked about now, and also new forms of networking and coalition building among different types of organization. We try to identify practices in all the five areas of intervention of this organization: service provision, advocacy and lobbying, collective bargaining, community building, and coalition building. But of course, the organization we are looking at, as it was said also before, they are using usually integrated strategies operating almost all of these areas of intervention. So we try to find the predominant area of intervention in order to identify practices that could be interesting. You will find a more detailed description of these practices in the report that will be put online. The survey provision, it was already said, usually they combine different services, legal and fiscal advice, social protection schemes, these are very important, including maternity and parental benefit and unemployment benefit, which are usually not accessible by IPROS, but also training services and professional upgrading services. This seems rather new among the services traditionally provided by this organization, support to in access to credit and mortgages, and of course also administrative support to reduce the administrative burden, which is usually a problem for these workers that are usually have many different activities. They are operating on different jobs and activity, and the administrative burden is usually very problematic. They also support these workers in customer relationship management, and they also provide consultancy services and coaching and account. The LMIs are a bit different because they also provide support in matching and placement. And the example we include in the catalog is the yacht. I don't know if this is the right way to pronounce it in the Netherlands. What is interesting of these services is that they are usually personalized according to the needs of the workers. For example, the training services provided by TAP in Spain, or the consultancy services provided by Mediacon, which is a specific branch of Verdi to provide specific consultancy services. They are provided in a very flexible way according to the need of the workers, either face-to-face or mail, or using a lot of internet platforms. And this use of platform services are very important because they also support the exchange among the users and community building and collective representation using this bottom-up approach that was talked about before. And usually these kind of services are funded through fees that are paid by users. They are usually differentiated between members and non-members, but in some cases they are provided free of cost as a way to recruit new members and to widen the membership of this organization. So these services are also used to support community building and to enlarge, to increase the membership. Advocacy and lobbying, I'm going very fast because all these issues were already treated. They are used to mobilize civil society in order to influence decision making, also through direct interaction with policymakers. They are usually promoted through specific campaigns, petitions, proposals, and guidelines, and also through networking, using again website and platforms as a way to mobilize workers. And also, of course, some of these organizations, not only unions, but also quasi-unions and other organizations, participate in parliamentary hearings during the legislative processes. They are usually meant to promote a formal recognition of the professions, the professional content of the work, to support copyrights, to support social protection rights, and also to support the more favorable taxation system, and also in some cases to define specific rules in terms of fees, working conditions, and so on. The most interesting are also very widely covered by the media, and so they are more effective, of course, the more they are covered. And also some interesting cases for campaigns that have been carried out, they are based on very detailed analysis of the needs of these workers. For example, the AJP campaign on freelancer not easily fooled was based on three or four surveys among IPROS workers in order to see how to create this campaign. So there is this attention, as Sarah was saying, on the needs of these workers. Networking is very important to improve the collective power and the capacity to influence policy making. There is an interesting case in Slovenia of this transformation of a movement, the Slovenian movement for decent work and welfare society, which started to promote very strong advocacy and lobbying activity, and then transformed itself in a trade union of precarious workers. So this type of activity is also a way to, in a sense, institutionalize some movements into trade unions. The most effective and innovative practices that we found, effective in meaning that they produced political and legislative results. So this is the measure, one of the indicators of efficacy, is the capacity to produce results in terms of legislative or political reforms in favor of these workers. They were effective because they were able to create new coalitions, so coalition building again is a very crucial tool, and also they were able to create very strong connection with political decision makers, and this was the case again in Italy. It was already described with quasi-unions like ACTAR that were able to create coalition involving a lot of other organizations, including unions at the end, and were able to arrive to the new Jobs Act for autonomous workers, which I think is rather innovative also in the European context. So it is a very interesting and effective case. Collective bargaining. Here it was difficult because, of course, usually it is unions that can carry out collective bargaining. All the other organizations cannot carry out collective bargaining. And so we can find some example of collective agreements, especially in those unionized sectors, especially in the UK, for example, where there are unions that are representing, for example, journalists or the media, workers that represent both dependent and independent workers. But there are also some interesting cases where there is a sort of bargaining, of negotiation, which does not take exactly the form of collective bargaining with unions, but it is introducing new ways of bargaining or negotiating on fees, on working time, on access to protection, and so on. For example, also in some cases, beside the UK case, some unions, for example, in the Netherlands, the Kustenbond Union, tried to broaden the boundaries of the collective agreement that were stipulated for employees, introducing specific clauses for the self-employed. In some cases, unions or quasi-unions try to introduce guidelines, protocols, and recommendations. For example, the Swedish Journalist Union recommended fees, minimum fees, payment times, royalty and copyrights rules, workplace safety conditions for journalists. The problem in these cases is take-up. There are rules, there are protocols, there are guidelines, but then in the concrete real world, sometimes the individual freelance worker is not able to pursue this type of fees. Sometimes they have to accept lower fees or longer payment times and so on. In some cases, quasi-unions in coalition with unions were able to reach some what we call civil agreements. For example, in Belgium, the AGP, which is a quasi-union, was able, together with the union, to define some rules in terms of fees, working times, and so on, that were valid also for self-employed workers and not only for employees. So the capacity to extend, in a sense, the contents of collective agreement from employees also covering self-employed workers. Coalition building, again, very important. It is probably the most, we already said it so many times, the most important type of intervention in order to get results. They are sectoral, in some cases, or transversal coalition among different organizations, unions, quasi-unions, but also associations and movement. They are crucial also according to the IPROS, who answered the survey. This morning it was, I think it was said. So this is also IPROS recognized the importance of coalition buildings. These practices can produce very important synergies also in terms of the type of services that can be provided to IPROS, but also in terms of political and legislative results. The Dutch case of the BZO, which is participating to the Dutch Social Economic Council, so it is involved in the social dialogue, mechanism in the Netherlands, and we already said the coalition between different organizations for the Italian Statute on Self-Employment. Community building practices are also important, I think, because they are bottom-up measure initiative to aggregate and strengthen the IPROS and reduce the isolation they feel and they live in. The isolation was also another issue that came up from the survey. And in order to be able to be represented and to find ways to get results, it is important that they are communities among these workers are really tough. And so the creation of physical or virtual spaces, which become often the reference points of activists and also It is interesting, they can also be used as a source of income for this organization because they can rent spaces or platform places to raise funds and to do other activities. They are ways to provide mutualized services. In some cases, they can be a way to support the creation of, and this is another important new thing, this new type of employers, this, the creation of cooperatives like Smart Bay or Copenham or others in other countries, which create a so-called a new type of employer. Cooperatives are employing freelance workers that want to do that, and so they can provide a lot of services and support their protect their rights and support their income, providing this type of new contractual
arrangement.
Mm-hmm. Because freelance are still autonomous, but they are hired by the cooperative, so they can have a lot of benefits from this. The other thing interesting is in the use of community building, especially online platform and these spaces, co-working spaces, is that also they support the development of new ideas, new businesses from this work, thanks to the reduction of their isolations. Let's go to the final part. It is main conclusions. It is very difficult to, we decided that we couldn't provide recommendation, policy recommendation at this stage. We wanted also to hear what people were saying in this meeting. So what we can say is some important issues that have to be discussed and for which there are different options available. The first thing is that the change in the nature of work, the diffusion of these new forms of employment relations, which means that they seem a worker can experience both being a dependent or independent worker at the same time or during the working life. So it is very difficult to distinguish between these different forms. Ask for a rethinking of the regulatory framework, but also of the welfare and social protection models of industrial relations and of the social dialogue. And they also ask for a rethinking of the conceptual approach, and this was said also now. However, there are so many different and so many complexity in the institutional framework in all countries that it is very difficult to find one solution for it for all. So it is a complex, it is difficult to find a solution. Probably we have to think about different type of solution going in the same direction. The first big issue is the issue of the legal status. We saw the Atlantic research. There are different differences in the definition of legal status. We have seen that in most countries there is this binary regulative approach. On the one hand, employees, dependent worker. On the other hand, the other workers that are not employees. And so freelance workers may be defined as independent contractor, entrepreneurs, employees of their own organization. And here the big issue, and it already came up today, is that if they are regulated and considered as entrepreneurs, it is there are a lot of barriers to the possibility to engage in collective demands. with collective representation organization, because there is the risk of breaching the antitrust and competition legislation and trade practices. So this is one important issue to be considered. We have seen in the research by Lentic that the presence of a hybrid status, which is usually was related to the so-called bogus, self-employed, does not really improve the situation, the protection of iProc. So this doesn't seem the way to be pursued, the solution. The other issue important is that those representative organizations, both old and new organizations that provide support to iProc, becomes very important as functional equivalents to the type of social protection and employment rights that now are guaranteed, especially to employees, to dependent workers. So for all these other segments of freelance, iProc workers, the only way to get access to certain type of rights and social protection is through this, the work of this representative organization. The second big issue is how to rethink social protection. They are self-employed are usually excluded from statutory access to social protection. They may only be able to opt in on a voluntary basis. There is a wide variation in formal coverage across countries, but also within countries, depending on the sector and the job. Usually, take-up is very low. Even if formal